All right, everybody, welcome to another video article tag team duo series here with Corey Burkhart. This week we're going to be battling some Gruul Pummeler. I'm going to lead off by saying that I'm actually starting directly from a 5-0 moto list. So what you're going to see here is, this is a lot of how I do my sort of adapting and learning decks right before a Grand Prix, as I'm actually looking to potentially play this deck at GP Denver. Which, at the point at which you guys will be watching this, will be this weekend. Basically, the reason why I think I want to be on Pummeler is that it has a good mono-red matchup. A lot of your creatures just sort of threaten the ability to kill them very quickly, grow out of the size of their removal slash their can't block effects in the case of Urshik or Kenra, and you have a very quick clock thanks to Pummeler and Hydra. And you can grow a bunch of your creatures too large where you can just block Hazoret for a while and then combo kill them with your Pummeler once you find it. The other sort of big deck right now, or at the time at which I record this, is Zombies. And the Zombie matchup is also, I think, quite favorable, as a lot of it is just a creature ground stall. And they need to find enough removal spells to sort of like power through and or make a giant horde of zombies to finish you off by going around you, as you tend to play very large threats and they tend to go widespread on the board. Diagraph Colossus and Dark Salvation among their better cards from my experience. They don't want to make the Diagraph Colossus potentially like a 4-4. What they really want to do is just jam it on threes where removal light and then try to go wide on the board. But I think this deck has a good matchup against both the monocolor decks. Has a reasonable matchup against, say, like, the Teemer Energy decks, but can be pretty soft to, like, heavy removal decks. Say, like, Blue-Red Control can be tricky when they line up answers on 2 and 3, and Blue-Black or, like, a Grixis Control-style deck could also be potentially dangerous. The sideboard we're working with here, we got a pair of Abrades, mostly to kill, like, either Sir Harvester's God Pharaoh's Gift, Heroic Intervention to stop this blue-white control decks coming back to fruition. Gotta stop Fumigate somehow. I'll be completely honest, I don't know what these Greenbelt Rampagers are for, but I'm going to board them in against every creature deck we play against, in which its size is relevant. Sweltering Suns, you'll see that come in against Zombies, and potentially Teemer Energy on the draw. It'll depend on how many Whirler Virtuosos we see them leave in. And then you've got this sort of go-pick package between Chandra, Glorybringer, and Sky Sovereign. But I'm a bit more skeptical of that plan in this version, as you'll see we have 20 lands, 4 tunes. We do have 4 servants as well, but you also want to cycle these sheltered thickets pretty frequently. Like, you want to go 2-drop, 3-drop, 4-drop if you can, but you don't want to be curving all the way to 5 lands fairly often. So, the Glorybringers and Sky Sovereign, I'm a little more skeptical on the 20 land version, but we will see how they play. So, what are we going to be looking to do in the games? Biggest thing is we want to be well on driving the action. As I said in the article, like, you need to be the one applying pressure to the opponent and keeping them on the back foot. If you can keep them on the back foot where they have to keep up and removal all the time, you can deploy the rest of your threats out and then get to a turn where you play like a Pummeler with the defense up, and then the next turn you go for it. Or you get to a point where you're playing Runoffs and Hydra and Cub, and the three of them combined are just not something that the opponent can realistically deal with. However, when you do have the deck's namesake card, you get to do some pretty filthy things thanks to Larger Than Life and Invigorated Rampage for the most part, but to a lesser extent, Blossoming Defenses and Runoffs certainly sort of carry their own weight, as well as any additional pumps you can give to the Pummeler all get doubled throughout the energy payment cycle, and this deck can pretty easily go off with 6 energy, meaning you get to quadruple Pummeler's power. So one pump from a Blossoming Defense or Runoffs is 12 power, and a Rampage or Larger Than Life usually leads to 20 power, which, right, last time I did math, we start with 20 life and 20 minus 20 is 0, and that's the ballgame. So let's get into the matches with this, and we will see how it goes. Alrighty, buddy, welcome to round number one here with some red-green Pummelers. What do we got here? Alright, so
Got a turn 2 Servant, a potential turn 3 Hydra, or potential turn 3 Pummeler with Blossom defense backup, so this hand's pretty nice. Not the sort of, you know, super stellar I had in a Toon hand, but definitely a hand I'm happy enough to be keeping. Alright, definitely going to still run out my Aether Hub here, just in case our opponent has, like, Thalia in their deck. Could be Mardu, we don't know. Could just be, like, red-white control or Jeskai control. Fatal push my Servant, that was rude. Alright, Attune. Tune right now. I'm trying to think if there's any reason to just go get a mountain here. It's like fairly unlikely we need to play multiple red spells in a turn. Yeah, I'm just gonna get another forest. Get another servant out there. We're going to have a lot of energy here with this Pummeler. So we basically just need a trample spell here and we can make it very deadly for our opponent. Alright, Harvester, don't really care, that's perfectly fine by me. Interesting. I just run out the Hydra now. Part of the desire to run out Hydra. See if they end up having Gideon. Can then attack both the Gideon. Then I have to pop my trick on my servant to kill the Gideon. That just seems lame. I think just setting up to have them dead on the board next turn is probably better. Scrounger. Alright, we racing back here with this Harvester. Puts us in a reasonable position as our opponent doesn't have any blockers back. We also don't have Revolt for push. So yeah, if I draw a Pump Spell, I'm almost assuredly killing my opponent this coming turn. Sheltered Thicket, however, is not that. So let's go ahead and cycle that. Harness Lightning isn't either. So now we have to figure out whether or not we want to try to play around a Braid. So we just Blossoming Defenses straight up, goes to a 3-3, then we can double it, and that's 24. My inclination is telling me to go for it, because my opponent didn't do anything on turn 2. Or in turn 1, they didn't do anything. Turn 2, they played a push on the Servant. Turn 3, they played Harvester. And then turn 4, they played Scrounger. So they had to have drawn Scrounger in the last two turns, or definitely afraid of what the Servant could sort of do. Like, obviously afraid of a Chandra. Just pretty bad follow-up then if I don't play the Hydra, at which point my Pummeler is just very open. Alright, I'm just going to play the Hydra. This might be very weak. It also might be incorrect to actually play this pre-combat, as then my opponent is very likely to slam a Braid on this. Instead of playing, they have some sort of damage-based removal, which I haven't seen too much out of. But I have seen some Mardu decks starting to adapt back to, like, Harness Lightning effects. Alright, so they did have a Braid. So yeah, definitely should have attacked first. I missed one damage there, and that was really bad. I'm sorry. So hopefully this Harness Lightning can take down something like an Avacyn for us. Second Harvester, okay. Another Shelter, okay, alright. I'm actually happy now that I have these Cycle Lands in the deck. Seldom does this occur. Alright, there's our Pump Spell, so now I feel even sillier for just throwing it away. So now I have to figure out how many times we're going to end up pumping here, as we're also going to need some amount of energy here off the Harness Lightning. 6, or 24. So 6, if I pump to 9 is 15. I get to have 6 damage potentially next turn. If I can blow up the vehicle that gets pumped with lifelink, assuming they don't have 2 creatures. We'll go ahead with that then. Yeah, let them go to blocks. Pump once. Pump twice. And this is 8. This puts them to 16. Imagine for some reason they don't have a creature. They only gonna make one of these harvesters. We let them attack with it. We Harness Lightning it. We go up from 3 energy to 6 energy. Go back down to 1 energy. We've hit them for 9 then in that world. They're at 15. We have 9 on the board and then 6 in our hand. Yeah, I think I want to pump one more time. Alright, so this is dicey around, say, Unlicensed Disintegration multiple ways, but... part of what it's aiming to do here is to get our opponent to pump the brakes to some degree. Alright, Pia is really not good for us. It's multiple defensive creatures that can block. It's also a mana sink that can use their mana pretty effectively and pump up. So if they try to attack for 9 here, end up pumping the harvester, getting through for 4 lifelink. Expect my pump to pass back here. Nope. Alright, so we're gonna take one less here, which will be nice. Pop this out of the skies. So do 5 to that, so they gain only 3 here. So they go up to 18, we have 9 on board, 6 in hand. So we certainly have some ways to do all this. Pummely, pummely, pummeler. Let's see, Harvester, Thopter. They animate the vent. So if they animate Shambling Vents and they're coming across with Vent, Harvester, Pia, Scrounger, representing 2, 5, 10 damage plus a Pia pump, which is 11. So simply blocking a single 3 power creature doesn't do it from our perspective. Thankfully, I don't have any energy left. Four energy. I think I need to attack with my Hydra to get them to 11. I go up to 13 with the vents. And I have 13 in hand. They try to make something unable to block. Let's say they use the Thopter to crew the Harvester. They throw the Thopter at something. Then they're a damage short, correct? Because Vents, Pia, Harvester get through in that world, and that's 7 points of damage, dropping us to 1. Say the Servant's unable to block, we then chump the Pummeler on the Scrounger. Yeah, so definitely getting in with this Hydra. And we have the ability to play around a removal spell thanks to Blossoming Defenses. Or play around a second Pia activation. If they end up having like a 3 of an Inspector plus land. Interesting, that mountains are their basic land of choice. So they base red black, so they don't have like Toolcraft, maybe? That would be very surprising to me. Scrounger, okay. So they can use the Scrounger now to crew. Then Shambling Vents off the Scrounger, throw the Scrounger. Put so much with 13. And I think then if I Blossoming Defenses the Servant, which I think is going to be unable to block, I think I actually hold up here. Block here, here, takes 6. I think I survived this, and I think because Invigorated Rampage, I think my triple pump there on the Blistering Hydra is going to end up being the deal breaker. So pump the Servant so it can still block. Block this guy and chump block this guy. Since they have no more energy, they're going to go to 13. We take 6, we fall to 2. They go to 13, we untap, we have a 7 power and a 2 power, which is 9, and then Invigorated Rampage does it. All right, sweet. That was a sweet game. I did not think we were winning that after I bumbled away 1 point of damage. Just for good measure, managed to find a larger in life. Whew. Alright, sweet little game one there. Alright, doesn't want the Abrades here. I think you can make an argument for the Sweltering Suns, but not going to be doing that here. Glorybringer, I think, is obviously great. Chandra, I don't think, is going to be as great on the draw. Alright, what are our cards we actively dislike here? I don't know if I should be trying to combo as much on the draw. Let's see, what are they going to be bringing in? They're mostly going to be bringing in a bunch of a control package, possibly more removal. For such a reason, we could be bringing in interventions, but I don't think that's exactly what we're looking for. This is much more a card you want against sort of Wrath-style effects. Not your Hour of Devastations, obviously, because it's been destructible, but Sweltering Suns, Kozilek's Return, Fumigate, things of that nature. Definitely going to bring in these, just trim these larger than lives. And I think I'm actually happy with the rest of this. Ronus is great here. Yeah, I don't want Sky Sovereign in a spot where it's just going to get abraded a lot. It's also, I don't think we're fighting a battle mostly over the small sort of creatures existing on the battlefield, but I could be mistaken. think I like a lot of what my deck is doing in game one, and I don't want to change that much, so let's do that. It's going to depend a lot on how our opponent actually sideboards here. If they board into the full control package, I don't know if my sideboard strategy is even at all reasonable, let alone good. Our hand here is pretty solid. Turn 2 Servant, potentially a turn 3. Pummeler with Blossoming Defense as backup. Potentially even just a Voltaic Brawler. Our opponent goes to 6, keeps their card on top. Attune with Aether. So now if I hub, I get to 2 energy. And then Game Trail untapped on the following turn. And then I have an untapped land the turn after. Otherwise, I'm going 2 drop and then 3 drop. That would allow me to go Servant, then Game Trail for an Attune, get a Forest. It's actually surprisingly better to just play Game Trail. I think if my hand had something to do with, like, to not have to burn energy multiple times on this Aether Hub, as I just want to accrue energy aggressively. If I didn't have to burn multiple energy, I think I'd be happier. All right, let's get down the hub. Get the Servant Ball out there. All right, 2 Pummeler is just going to be one extra pump spell maybe for Ronus and Pummeler to do some tag team duo actions here. License Disintegration, you take 6. Ow. Not my ideal turn. Little Cubby. This Cub's a really great draw that sort of shows off. Well, I didn't want to burn energy there off the hub. Alright, rip little cub. My opponent have a Pia too. A Thalia, okay. Yeah, that's a little less great for us. Definitely in a spot where I'm probably just playing Pummeler. Yeah, just looking to draw Invigorated Rampage and just try to combo off. So I don't currently have a trample effect, but I do have 20 points of damage. My opponent decides to bash me with both creatures and doesn't have, say, like, an Abyssin or something to block with. Alright, well, I can't beat an Abyssin, but I have 20 points of damage, so I'm going to go for it. Alright, hope here isn't my opponent just abrades the Pummeler. Nope, alright. Pump one of their defenses and double it up twice. Casual 20 ball. 20 ball corner pocket. Alright, sweet. Good job, Pummeler. Alright, so there you see the power of, you know, this card in general and why players like William Huey Jensen chose to play to the Pro Tour. We'll be back with round number 2 here in just a minute. Alright, everybody, welcome back for round number 2 here with some pummeling. It's a pretty weak hand. I think I'm going to throw this back. I think this hand's really close, and I think that maybe somebody more experienced with the deck would know if that's a keep or not, more so than myself. This, however, I am going to keep it. I don't like it. Opponent also went to 6. Attune on top. Alright, it's going to slow me down even further, but I'm going to keep the Attune because it is a mana source. And with only 19 other lands in my deck, it seems excessively greedy there to bottom that. Ooh, my opponent with the lucky turn 1 Attune. Very jealous. Getting a mountain. I'll however be getting a forest here. Oops. I'm very silly. Alright, well, shucks. Oops on me. Hopefully it doesn't punish us too much. Cub-a-dub-dub. Definitely would rather have played my land there than not. And it's obviously going to punish us here to some degree. So I immediately follow it up, drawing a sheltered thicket. Alright, we'll try not to focus on that. Try to focus on our opponent not getting extra energy here for this cub. And us finding a way to stick this pummeler and try to protect it long enough by gaining energy and then combo them off. Rogue Refiner? Virtuoso. Ooh, Virtuoso is like really good against this deck from my experience playing it. Alright, little cub, I can't really block you effectively. Pump it up to a 4-4. Do we want to pump you? So if we pump it, we end up back down at 3 energy after resolving our second brawler. Makes me believe that we do here. I don't expect my opponent to do something crazy like Megathopter there and double block. It'd be a dream come true, but not something I expect to happen. So this matchup against Teamer Energy, a lot of this is just like who can control the board and then seeing if you can set up a turn with usually with the defense's backup on your pummeler to just make a giant, unstoppable, uncanny large trample machine. Alright, so this cub can be a 6 power. Yep, we'll just keep getting smacked in the face by this giant cub. Runas can't really block at this point. That's unfortunate. Here, it doesn't really make much sense to trample up the brawlers, as what's most likely to occur is a double block with two virtuosos on one. That being said, if that gets set up, my opponent's setting up for like a weird spot where they get blown up by a harness landing, but obviously I would want to be using the harness landing on the cub if I had any other way to get another source of energy. I think my best way actually to win this is to attack with both, trample both of them, hope my opponent doesn't line up a block, play my pummeler, and then try to just rampage the turn after. We'll see how this plays out for us. So I certainly can't win the long game, as my opponent's got the giant cub, and I don't really think I can beat a removal spell. Alright, unfortunately, my opponent didn't make the double block. Alright, using your mana efficiently here, play a chump blocking pummeler. More virtuosos. So many virtuosos. Alright, opponent presents the lethal attack. Alright. Can't super effectively get through here. We're going to attack and see if we can get our opponent to, you know, make a Thopter here. And a block so we can play two spells in a turn again. As we are doing some, you know, reasonable damage here. Alright, they're gonna go for it. Sweet. So our blossoming defenses here is gonna allow us to trample over for two, getting our opponent to 10. And then we'll have the Cub ready on defense. Jump block away again. Alright, the Tomb presents lethal one more time, so now we have to block the Cub again if our opponent attacks with both. We got another Force there? That's interesting. Alright, opponent makes the safe attack, which I think is correct from their perspective here. They have a Hydra to follow it up. Oh, Servant, okay. These things are all a lot less good for us. Yeah, our opponent casting three spells that turn. Way less great for us. Even if we end up drawing the land here that we really need. Can't make any profitable inroads on this board. Runners can't block, of course, because we need a power creature with 4 power or greater. Alright, I think we are finally dead here. So I don't think we can any longer rebuild from that spot, even though we were trying to build ourselves into a spot where we could battle back. Alright, on the draw, I'll be boarding in the Sweltering Suns, I'm pretty sure. On the play, I'm not really into those. I'm going to bring in all the sort of like 240 effects of the Sky Sovereign, the Chandra, the Glorybringer. And in place of those, the Voltaic Brawlers get brickwalled pretty quickly, but we do need extra twos. The Ronuses are really good as they don't really ever leave the battlefield. Your opponent can be boarding in like Kefnet's Last Word Confiscation Coup, but not something I'm particularly mindful of. And we need to cut one more card. It's kind of larger than life. And I think this is what I want to submit on the play, and then we'll change it up somewhat with a little less of the combo and aggression for more Sweltering Suns, a braid type mid-rangey nonsense on the draw. Alright, well, it doesn't have the turn one attune, but this hand is more than acceptable. Pun also seems to have found a more than acceptable opener. Which is just so unlucky. How could they ever have a real good opener? There's a nice thing about all these green decks in Standard with Attune and Traverse and Vessel and Oath of Nyssa. Like, there are just so many keepable hands. The green decks are very good at reducing variance on their opening hands and makes it much easier and much happier to keep good 7-carders, which leads for, I think, more fun games, so. Oh no, is our Cubby gonna die? Rip Cubby. Uh-oh. Maybe I'm boarding a creature. Should have boarded out more Invigorated Rampages. Alright, with the Virtuoso on the stack here, I'm just gonna just pop it out. I don't want them getting Thopter blockers also. Alright, we'll definitely happily take a mountain. Would also accept Aether Hub. Yeah, Blistering Hydra is a little rude. All right, well, we are really set up when we find additional mana plus a Pummeler. However, we've drawn, you know, the sideboard action and then not the lands to cast it. Potential flaw with the strategy of, you know, if these were Voltaic Brawlers, we'd certainly be in the game. All right, pump once with the Hydra, yep. How much do I have to actually kill this silly Servant of the Conduit? like it to be not at all, but it doesn't feel like that's where I'm at. Yeah, I think this is my inexperience with this matchup showing. I feel like I have a bunch of cards that are just sort of disjointed pieces in my deck that maybe when I'm doing this sideboard strategy of trying to go slightly bigger and boarding out a few creatures, I need to board out more of these pump spells. Boarded out two large and lies, but it's possible you just need to board out like two rampages as well. Let's pop this River Finder. Alright, well, we are dead here then. Alright, we'll be back for round number three. Alright, back for round number three here with some pummeling action. Certainly going to keep this hand. Doesn't have, say, the two or three drop follow-up that I'd like, as I don't really want to play this Pummeler until four, but do have strong potential here in this hand with the Pummeler. Let's get ourselves a forest. Blue-red control here. Fortunately, I did not find a 2-drop follow-up. That's a being. So, plan is probably to lead. Run us, hoping this gets countered. If it doesn't, they'll lead straight into Hydra. Cub-a-dub-dub in the tub. Alright, gonna save the Cub for a spell where I could potentially play two spells. Is this spell is usually one the blue-red control deck doesn't really care about. They don't really want to counter it, as they just want to fight over all the other spells you have. So, me trading that first spell, I think, is pretty important from my perspective. Alright, Hub, I'm still a green short or an energy short of being able to protect the Hydra if it somehow resolves. I think I'm just going to slam Pummeler here. Sort of expecting this to get countered, but if it doesn't, then happy that I'm at least in, you know, air quotes, reasonable shape. So I can start trading protection spells here for spells out of my opponent's hand. Alright, so opponent didn't glimmer or illuminate there, so that's pretty great for us. Whoa, Sacred Desert of the Mindful? What in the world? Be honest, I haven't seen Desert of the Mindful out of a blue-red deck yet, so that is very shocking to me. I don't even know what that could mean. Alright, so we have a, you know, not exactly a kill on board, because our opponent could block a Fumarole, but I think it's also just a little crazy to go for that. I mean, if my opponent would ever give me the option to double pump my Pummeler to kill their Fumarole, I would take that, but I don't think I'm going to get that option either. So I think here I'm going to lead on Hydra. Probably expect this to get Supreme Willed or something of that nature. Does get Supreme Willed. Alright, three cards left in my opponent's hand, so fortunately could be in a tricky spot here against the dreaded Gear Hulk. So part of this turn is considering, can I possibly win the game if they do have a Gear Hulk? My answer more than likely is no. My answer more than likely is no. Can only double once, unfortunately, as I spent an energy for that Hydra last turn. So I can really just push 18 here. God, even attacking just feels so bad. I mean, I guess what I could try to do is see if they'll like animate their Fumarole, that way I could invigorated Rampage and then pump. I mean, I guess if they Gear Hulk and then just Supreme Will. I mean, that doesn't end up like too horrendously for me. Probably sneaking in 1 point of damage here that I wasn't otherwise. Alright, sweet. We'll definitely take that. Alright, need bottom here pretty hard. Top. Well, that's the exact opposite. I think my opponent's just considering whether or not they should be doing this main phase, but... Alright. Big draw for Blossoming Defense. Tune with Aether. Alright, well... It's not a Blossoming Defense, but... It'll play. See, if it weren't an abrade in my opponent's graveyard, let's say it were just a magma spray, I could actually get this pummeler out of range. But given that it's an abrade and they can just shatter my pummeler, makes this a lot more dicey, a lot trickier. So I mean, I'm trying to figure out if there's any way to actually get around this the way I would like. One of the things I'm thinking about right now is like, what happens if I larger than life my Long Tusk Cub and then just go to combat? I think that might be what I'm going to do, actually. This way I can still make inroads even if my opponent has the Gear Hulk, which I think they're likely to have. I guess it's theoretically possible my opponent top-topped and just literally had nothing, but that seems like a far cry from reality to me. Alright, so they did have Gear Hulk, so I definitely feel better. Hopefully now they just Glimmer. Alright, they're gonna braid. Alright, later, Pumlar. I'm gonna have to pump up this cub a lot of times. My opponent's chomping? Wow, okay. My opponent is all about preserving that life total. I can respect that. Alright, so this gets our cub to a 5-5. Unfortunately, we'll still die to a harness landing because our opponent's on 4 energy, but. Allows us to also bank up 3 more energy here, potentially. Jace? That's not very friendly. Alright, Cope, come on back. Alright, really like a Hydra draw at this point. How about more energy? Won't complain about having more energy, but few more spells would be nice. Preferably not more Ronuses that we'll be boarding out, but just more sweet Haymaker spells we could use against our opponent. I mean, thankfully they're on 2 cards, so I'm just going to guess that what they ended up topping there was Jace and Gearhulk, because they knew the Gearhulk was very likely to keep them in it. Yep, Supreme Will to Impulse. Yeah, maybe my mistake here. This game was not just trying to jam 19 or 20 points with the Pummeler there on 5. Alrighty here. 3, 5, 8. Mother, may I play Long Toes Cub? Alright, giving us hope. They have a lot of card filtering in their deck between Supreme Will, Anticipate, and Jace. It's a lot more I'm used to. Alright, we have a Pummeler on the battlefield. Not out of the woods just yet, their opponent. Gearhulk for a Glimmer. Yep, alright. Alright, a bottom and a... Alright, this game's not over. I would say we're very unlikely to win, but... You know, our opponent doesn't have any, you know, air quotes removal to deal with the Pummeler just yet. I say air quotes because there's a Jason on the battlefield that... You know, it's minus 2 isn't really removal, but it was temporary removal there for the Lantos Cub. We left the card on top. Rats. Sweltering Suns, huh? Alright, well, we'll pump up Cubby twice. Okay. Yeah, I think if we don't draw something really fantastic this draw step, we will be certainly no longer a part of the game. Alright. Pretty well played game there by our opponent. Possibly should have gone for it a lot sooner. Alright, here we're basically going to be bringing in most of these, cutting the Ronuses, the pump spells. And I think 2 Pummelers. I likely even the Harness Lightnings, as usually opponents will bring in a Thing in the Ice. Oops, I do not want you guys in the same pile. These in the same pile. So 9 for 10, so let's keep one more Pummeler in here. Let's see, we want a Sky Sovereign, Heavens No. Still don't want Ronas. Not in the marketplace for Braid. Alright, we'll call that a day. So we're much less combo nature ground the Pummelers here in the post-board games, and mostly just like a good sort of like big red-green beats deck. As with Abrades and Sweltering Suns, it's not going to be super simple for our opponent to be dealing with that. And Heroic Intervention can help us against, say, Sweltering Suns as well. Right, definitely be on the play here for game two. We'll certainly keep this hand. I think I'm going to go turn two Voltaic Brawler. So just playing a Sheltered Thicket tapped, as it'll function as a second green source here, allowing us to do some sweet things with our Green Belt Rampager to keep gaining energy. It'll also be a second red source for Glorybringer later on. We just want a four power haster that, you know, for lucky, we'll eat up a Thing in the Ice or a Dragon Master Outcast or something of that nature. All right, four power beaters on turn two. Usually a good start against a control deck, so hopefully we don't get Magus Braid or Abraded or Heartland's Lightning. You know, hopefully there's no removal spell for this and we can start leveraging this to push our agenda. All right, so much for that story. Just gonna try to make this the Greenbelt Rampager show. Ooh, no third land. Okay, I was gonna say, what in the world? Yeah, if my opponent wants to counter this, I'd be very happy. Let's get ourselves another mountain. Expect my opponent to Supreme Will here on end step, keep digging into more potential answers. Ooh, nothing? That's good for us. This means we're going to be slamming Glorybringer into 4 mana, so instead of our opponent being able to draw cards here, they're going to have to counter or fight over this Glorybringer. We need to follow it up with another threat, though, is the important thing. Alright, I'm going to play the Aether Hub now, that way if we end up peeling a second one, the Cub can get 2 points larger. Alright, so we do get to put our opponent to 10, and they have no Glimmer. Alright, well now we just need to hope for no Hour of Devastation, because that would be exceptionally brutal for us. That's brutal. Chandra? Senior Pummeler. Senior Pummeler. You would end up needing some extra help. I think I'm just going to play Cub Pummeler here. Alright, really need to dodge the second Hour of Devastation now. Thing of the Ice, that is fine. Sweltering Suns. Alright, we'll pump up the Cub twice here. Alright. Trust in the little cub. Cycle this, see if we can find any better action for us. Chandra here would be particularly nice. Awesome defenses. Well, not the worst thing in history, but probably not going to close the door on its own. Very much so need to protect this long-tailed cub like it's our whole life, because at this point, looking at this board state, it's worth our whole life. Thankfully, we have an energy to get over this Fumarole, so our opponent does need to have, say, a Gear Hulk. And we can get through the Gear Hulk thanks to Blossoming Defenses. Again, this would be a really good spot for one of our energy creatures, a Chandra. Glorybringer would be good here, but not as good as, say, a Blistering Hydra. Well, another cub is fine, not excellent. So we will have some interesting choices here on combat. Alright, so interesting concept here in combo. We might want to use Intervention and Blossoming Defenses to also try to kill the Gear Hulk off. So if our opponent does Gear Hulk here on a Harness Lightning, we Heroic Intervention to that. And then Blossoming Defenses to +2/+2 to get over the Gear Hulk. Flip side of that is if we just Blossoming Defenses, it's possible we can just get the Gear Hulk to chump block anyways. Alright, so we Blossoming Defenses this. We go to 6/6. I think that works out slightly better. I don't think my opponent's super likely to chump block, and then having 4 energy in the bank makes it so we can just get over the Gear Hulk anyways the next turn. Yeah, alright. So they also see the reason to jump there, so that's good for us. Again, need to dodge another Hour of Devastation here, but it's been the case anyways, I think, for a while. Scavenger Grounds. Alright, so they are doing something with these deserts. Jace. Alright, well, we're going to Hexproof this activation. Does this allow one cub to kill off Jace and the other cub to get in on the face? It's getting disallowed? Okay. Alright, so we're going to have to burn the energy here to cub down the Jace. I don't have a hand left, so that's pretty nice. Reasonable board of amigos here. Glimmer off the top. That's not what we want to see. Bottom and top, alright. Do find an untapped land, so they could block a Fumarole here. So getting with the Pummeler here is pretty worthless. It just gets munched up by the Fumarole. However, we could basically spend 3 energy on it to gain ourselves energy the other way. So I think it actually is going to be worth just sending everybody here. is putting the fumarole in front of somebody. I expect the 3-3 cub, maybe. All right, let's pump up this other cub. I guess I probably should have done this potentially before blocks. Yeah, I'm not incentivized to just kill this cub or this fumarole, but potentially wanted to do it before blocks to play around a magma spray. Harness lining with access to 5. Alright. Cub down. I expect that to be the card that they topped. And an abrade. Alright. So we just need a big threat here. Not a big threat. I think we still have a turn or two. I guess their opponent has a lot more air in their deck than we do. Uh-oh. Anticipate. Card filtering. Probably into a draw spell. No, into Fumarole. Alright, it's not the worst for us. Servant's not exactly the follow-up I was looking for. Blossoming defenses. So not exactly the piece of the puzzle we're looking for there. Opponent's just holding on to 2 cards here. Hopefully it's just like 2 medium counter spells. Ooh, we'll definitely take a Cubby Dub Dub. Ooh, Cubby Dub Dub resolves. Definitely happy about that. Still don't think there's much of a reason to attack. I think it just offers up too many like huge negatives and not enough high positives. I guess it's possible if my opponent had a Gearhulk, they would have just flushed it in and blocked, or sorry, and disallowed the cub anyways, rather than trying to get the block and getting a Glimmer off, but I think Glimmer's just way better in that spot. There we go. 14th hub here doesn't do too much for us. Definitely going to serve up with both here. At a minimum, we need a bunch of mana for our opponent's Fumarole. Not that their mana is super likely to be relevant at this point, but have to win the game somehow, right? Alright, firing up the little elemental. They block the servant here. It's going to be a little interesting. Alright, well, I guess now we're going to find out what's happening here. So I expect they're going to know they get to chump block now. Or they just snap let that resolve too. Okay. Well, now they're just going to chump block. We'll pump the cub once as to not lose our creature. Assuming that they do just flip their fumarole for the free roll. Nope, they didn't want to expend the energy. Fine by me. Alright, man, just still game 2, so that's pretty sweet. See if we can ever change anything up here for game number three. Again, I think all the ramp spells are not where we want to be. They have a bunch of wrath effects, so I think the heroic interventions are solid again, except for against Hour of Devastation. Played out nicely there, even to just buy a counterspell from them. Yeah, I think we're just going to run this back. Fortunately, I'm going to be on the draw here for game number three. Should make things like Sensor a little bit more devastating, and something like a Magma Spray exceptionally more appealing from my opponent's perspective. Yeah. One creature, a million lands. If one of these were a cycle land, I would certainly keep this hand. So given them none of them are, I'm going to toss this back. Yeah, that's unfortunate. Alright, definitely going to keep this. Shelter Thicket? No, I can just get a random card instead of you. Alright, that helps out a little bit. So now we can build up some energy here before needing to play our Launtusk Cub. Get up to 3 energy here, thanks to Servant, and then I expect Servant to die. Next turn, I plan to just run out the Pummel and get up to 6 energy, and then all the way up to 9 energy, hopefully with the... Ooh, that changes things a little bit. So if I get a forest, I'm only at 5 energy still is the issue. I think I just need to maximize the threat potential of all my cards, so I think I'm still just going to run out Pummeler here. If I just peel a land, if my opponent just like... I mean, I don't even know why they would do such a silly thing, like main phase of spell here, but... Ooh, disallow on a Pummeler. That's good. It means it's unlikely they have more just removal. It means if we can resolve this cub, it's much more likely to stick around. Definitely tune for forest here. I have Cubby. The little Longtusk Cubby. Oh, what a wonderful cub for me. Alright, sweet. Cubby's down. That's unfortunately a glimmer. Alright, kept one, bottom the other. So even if our opponent has an Hour of Devastation here, he can spend an energy to play the Blossoming Defenses and then pump the cub twice. And then if we peel out a red source, we can still slam Chandra. Alright, well, I'm definitely gonna Blossoming Defenses this. The hope here now is that our opponent has to like spend the rest of their mana countering back, and then can somehow leverage Chandra to finish the rest of the game. No, I would not like to pay for your mana leak effect. And no, I don't want to spend my energy to waste your energy. At a 2-to-1 rate. Alright, so we do get to get all their energy there, and we're going to slam the Chandra. And hopefully take her all the way up to ultimate. Let's go ahead and deal some damage to our opponent. No, I would not like to cast a card that I can't cast. thing in the ice. Not too concerned of the thing in the ice just yet. Let's go ahead and play our mountain out. We'll plus Chandra again. Flip to game trail. Let's get the servant out. Essence scatter my servant. All right, so I'm going to try to do 4 damage here to Chandra with the Wandering Fumarole. Who didn't attack it? That's good for us. I have to cycle this. Alright, a little bit of a unfortunate scenario there. It's possible we want to hold that attune, but our opponent, in the face of Chandra about to ultimate, is not going to just let her tick up again. No real reason to hold this land. This is not like we have trackers in our deck to get to the point where we want to draw 5, 6, 7, 8 lands. Our opponent have a Gearhulk. Alright, that's probably going to be the end for us unless we draw something very, very effective here in the next turn. Kept one of the cards off of Glimmer. Alright, Fumarole, flip it. Opponent's also getting to the point where they might be able to use Thing in the Ice to pick up their Gearhulk to disallow something. Also known as the Embarrassment of Riches turns. Alright, well, I have a Glorybringer. For better or for worse. For worse. Alright. GG's opponent. Back for number 4 shortly. Ooh, won the die roll. It's a good start. Got a turn 2 Cubby, turn 3 Runas, maybe a turn 4 Hydra. Definitely in for this. Gonna lead on the Sheltered Thicket here. Obviously great when you can cycle these little cycle lands, but when you get to play them out as a mana source and they actually look good like they do in this hand, it also feels great. Scavenger Ground. So I'm going to assume this is either red or red colorless or black colorless Eldrazos. That's what I would expect from this. Palmer is also a pretty nice one to get. Especially because we played the best turn 2 threat here to lead into it. Oh, maybe it's just a ramp deck? If it's a ramp deck. Alright, so now I'm much more likely to do what, per se? So if I play Runas this turn, I can definitely guarantee it attacks in the following turn. So I think our best play is to go for that. So there's very few ways Runas is dying. It's usually Hour of Devastation or Bust. I think that's better than Pummeler, but I could be mistaken. I guess we can just do some quick math here. So with Pummeler this turn, we get up to 3 energy. So we go up to 5 energy. Turn after, I play a tune, I go up to 7 energy. Invigorated Rampage. I mean, I guess I'm literally just looking at a turn 4 kill. So with 7 energy, I have 2 pumps in Pummeler. Yeah, I guess this is fine. Because if my opponent goes land Kozul extra turn, I guess I'm just at the spot where which is at the spot where I could just pump my cub. Keep it around. I don't necessarily need this Pummeler. And then Runas, I can just turn on the line the turn following by going attune. Alright, Cyclone Beneath the Sand's fine by me. Go attune, get a mountain, play Runas, and then the turn after play Hydra. Alright, so my opponent doesn't have any mana up here that really terrifies me, so I'll be going for it. Yep, alright, they're done. Alright, well, good thing I didn't do anything silly there. plus 4 plus. So, pump. And pump. Alright, just like modern druid up. Oh, wait, this is standard. Right. Alright, so in this matchup. This matchup, I expect my opponent to potentially board in, say, a Braids and or other cheap spot removal to try and interact with us. Another key thing is they don't already have access to, say, Sweltering Suns, Kozilek's Return. Those should be things that are on their radar. As for such, the only real cards out here are bad or Harness Lightning. And I think I'm just going to upgrade those with some Rampagers. I'm looking at this one copy of Heroic Intervention. It's just so bad against Hour of Devastation. I'm trying to figure out if I like want one copy of Chandra, or maybe I just want to leave in one Harness Lightning in case my opponent brings in, like, Evans, I don't even know, like, Jotty Offshoots or something crazy, where I just want to kill that thing before they gain, like, six life off of it. But spending 2 mana to kill, like, a Jotty Offshoot just sounds pretty bad to me also. So I think we will roll with a Singleton copy of Chandra. Yeah, holding my mana seems bad. I think this matchup's too much about trying to be as proactive as possible and getting your opponent dead, such that sitting there and trying to hold up mana just sounds pretty silly to me. Sounds pretty great. Turn one, Toon. Turn two, Cub. Obviously getting Force with our Toon, so we could potentially turn on these Hydras later. Ooh, double Cane Trail. Very nice, very nice. All right, so we're gonna have potentially a 3-3 Cub to lead off with here. See, our opponent has a 2 this turn. Nothing again, all right, that's good for us. Right, so this can't get Magma Sprayed, however, it could still get a Braided or something. But if it gets a Braided, we're obviously fairly happy with that. Perfect. It means our Pummeler is going to be ready and roaring for some action. Gift of Paradise, gain 3 life. That's a little rude. I have to do 23 damage? Jeez. Alright, well, the extra lands are not going to serve us well here. We are set up well for our Pummeler. We have a bunch of energy, we just need a pump spell or two. Yep. Put another ramp spell of sorts. Access to 5 mana here. Just getting houred. And a Heb. Okay. Man, more lands. Not great. Get down the old Blistering Hydra here. Fortunately, can't make any inroads on the battlefield. So this is going to gain them either 3 or 4 mana, is that right? For each one life your opponents have lost this turn. So they either get it to 8 mana or 9 mana. And if I choose to put it at 8, then I have to double pump my Hydra. Obviously they could just have Hour Devastation here and clean up both my guys. Destroy target artifact, deal. Thankfully, opponent's only actually on 5 lands on the battlefield, which means we're unlikely to face down anything too terrible. Alright, Beneath the Sands changes that, so. Now they have access to 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, so 10 on the next turn. So awful, terrifying, scary things can happen. did draw a spell, however. Would have been nicer to pair with the pummeler. Alright, how many times do you want to pump here? Certainly once. I think that's it. Spending 9-11 points on the battlefield right this second. Obviously need to draw another good spell here. Alright, one of those access to even more mana now. So they have literal 9 just in their lands, because the Gift of Paradise land taps for 2, and the Shrine now taps for 2 for colorless spells. So if Snap attacks, I'm expecting an Ulamog to come down. Which I'm not like that far off of beating, I guess. Get the Brawler down, that gives me additional points of energy here to pump up these Hydras. Definitely just going to swing with both here. If Neheb comes flying across the red zone next turn, it's not like I'm planning on blocking. I'm assuming my opponent's trumping this turn even. No. Alright, so they're 18. So if I pump this Hydra twice, that's 11. All right, yeah, we're gonna put them to 7, I think. Leave up in 4 here. So I don't think my opponent's hand can really contain a spell, because I think they're supposed to just suicide their Neheb there. Also, it would just be better to cast their spell for Seagate Wreckage, as they really just want to be drawing extra cards here. It seems fairly clear to my opponent this does not have spells. Alright, yep, I'll take the 4 damage. You can have all the mana in the world. Watch, probably Gift of Paradise for, like, black or something silly. And I'm going to look really foolish for playing out that extra land I didn't need to. That'd be kind of great, actually. Pay 5, sack 2 creatures, discard 2. Right, cycle. Maybe I can fade. Hash up Oasis. To call a spell. At least cost 6. Is it a Worldbreaker? Oh, looks like it is. The Ulamog Father. Alrighty here. They're at 7 and they're going to try to hit both Hydras. So if I pump this Hydra. Yeah, they're just dead. Alright, so Blossoming Defense is the 7-6 Hydra. And then we'll pay energy on the 4-3 Hydra, and then we'll attack with everybody, and we're going to get in through for 8 damage, or 7 damage. Or, sorry, 8 damage or 10 damage, depending on how you look at it. Alright, double hexproof, nice 10-10. Good old-fashioned Hydra beatdowns. Sometimes good enough. Alright, sweet. On to the last round. Alright, back for the final round here with some Gruul Pummeler action. I think if you trade any card in this hand for a basic land, I would keep this, but given that that's not how Magic works, toss it back for a much more respectable hand. An Aether Hub. I think that this hand can function pretty reasonably off 2 mana. And while the Aether Hub's a reasonable land, like, it actually forces me to spend energy to get the Voltaic Brawler out just to pump the Cub. So this Aether Hub energy would be basically exclusively for a Voltaic Brawler. Makes me kind of want to bottom this, but I think I'm going to leave it on top. Just going to hope the power run us here. Cubby can get it to a 4-4. Planar is to curve Cub into Conduit. Well, in this case, sorry, Cub into Run Us into Servant. That way we can pump the Cub up to a 4-4 and get in. But if for some reason we need to get the Cub over top of something, we'll play Servant first. Put the Aether Hub there, such that if I draw a second one, I can actually grow the Cub a single time. I think that's a mistake I see a lot of people make playing just energy style decks in general. I know it was a big thing before last GP Denver, back when it was basically the coming out party of Red Green Marvel and Teamer Marvel, was just knowing how to manage your energy was very important. And the people that really knew how to do that were the ones that were exceptionally successful. Oh, rip Cubby. Alright, so I'm going to turn one energy into two here to get a brawler out. And have a way to protect it so we can push a reasonable amount of damage here now. I think if I'd had that Blossoming Defenses earlier, I would have played the Servant out to lead. Waterliner Virtuoso. Battle in here, definitely spend the energy. Don't expect my opponent ever actually to trade in this position. I'm just gonna follow up here, I believe, with Ronas. Allows me to, if I just flood out and draw another land next turn, I could just play Servant, pump Servant. Start whittling through my opponent's resource, and then if they do happen to have like a Chandra or something, kill the Voltaic Brawler in a very similar situation to what I just described. Alright, Harness Landing more Brawler, that's fine. Their own Cubby, alright, well that's less than fine. So now we're in one of those interesting predicaments. Like, we can get in with Runas. It'll get chump blocked by a Thopter, but then the Lantus Cub just gets through us. So I think we're just going to lay out Servant. Fortunately, probably just hold up this turn. And then look to pump Servant on defense so Runas can block. Alright, opponent making two Thopters for us is not bad. Now the Cubs aren't going to be big threats. Alright, Harness Lightning here. Definitely don't like continually sitting here. It's just a matter now of how do we want to start whittling away at their resources with Runas. We're reasonably well set up to draw Pummeler. give it Trample with Runoss, pump it with Blossoming Defenses, and then soup up its stats once or twice. I think I'm going to pass one more time. See if this Harness Lightning can catch something like a Glorybringer. That's not exactly the kind of card we wanted to see. See, I feel like in general, Pummeler should be reasonably well set up for this matchup. For these specific reasons, it's like, the board gets bogged down, they have so many ways to just see extra cards. Makes it difficult to sort of make inroads on the opponent. Because you basically just have to find Pummeler and combo off a lot of the time, it feels like. But it doesn't feel like these sort of go-wide creature decks should be that much of an issue. Alright, Hydra's a good draw. Alright, so we're in a pretty reasonable spot now, given that we have a bunch of energy to spend. We're not going to want to spend an energy out the Servant of the Conduit here to Harness Lightning at all this turn, but the Blistering Hydra is going to give us a... What in the world? Okay, so both of these cubs get through. So what I want to do is I want to put Hydra on one of the cubs. Because I just don't want my opponent making more Thopters, and I'm trying to figure out if I'm throwing away the Servant for the Rogue Refiner. I think that I am, because I'm likely to just spend an energy to kill the Long Tusk with the Harness Lightning. In response to it, trying to get a counter, that way I end up with the same amount of energy. So we're all good to this. Alright, try to pump through that cub. We will kill that cub. So at least this is 6 energy here. So, with the ability to give Blistering Hydra Trample, so we can pump it to 6, then we can pump it currently once only, so we can get to 8 power Trampler. And Runoss definitely just gets to eat a Thopter token here. Ooh, Blossoming Defenses, that's nice. Pump that up right now. Sky. So that gets up to 7 power, Blossoming Defenses is 9, and extra energy is 10. Let's see, they have 5 toughness back. One of it needs to go on Runoss on the following turn. I'm just trying to see if it's correct to use the other energy that we have. I don't think that it is. Let's put them down to 4 here. Tap to red immediately. Even a Glorybringer would have to stay back on defense, I think. Aether Sword Harvester. Alright, that's a little bit more annoying. That one also gains a life. So by not spending the energy, we did leave open our ability to draw a harness lightning here. We then drew a forest. It's not bad either. So Thopter then has to block Ronas. Hydra has to get blocked by the Harvester. We pump it twice to a 9 power. Lifelink, they take 1. Alright, so this isn't going to kill them, but is going to do severe damage. Opponent's going to need to chain like a Rogue Refiner to something awesome here. Let's see, pump this guy up to a 9, use its energy as 10, this is 2 trampling over. Yeah. So 4 trampling over, lifelink, they take 1. Yeah, so there's no reason to use the energy. Alright, ship it back. Alright, sweet, 1 game 1. Good job, Ronas. I wonder if this is a matchup you're supposed to be boarding against Sweltering Suns. It doesn't feel like it is. Again, I think this is just for red and zombies, but in theory, this does kill a large subset of their creatures. I mean, it's not really ever killing Blistering Hydra, but what really is? Let's see. So no, I may not have boarded very well the first time I played this matchup. Theory Glorybringer seems fine. Theory Chandra seems good. Theory Braid seems fine. Sky Sovereign seems actively good. Bring in Sky Sovereign. And let's shave on those. Shave on a Brawler or two. Actually, just cut all the brawlers. We do that, then allows us to do this. We're getting all the big stuff. The reason why I like most of the big stuff here is, like, yes, a lot of their cards are sort of these value creatures, but specifically the problem one is Whirler Virtuosos. It makes a bunch of Thopters, and if they're not making a bunch of Thopters, then Chandra does a pretty good job at just really harassing our opponent. They're better getting, you know, widespread creatures when they have Virtuoso, otherwise it really revolves around Rogue Refiner just drawing them a ton of cards. I'm trying to see how that's the way I want to take the game rather than just, like, putting Brawler back in. Yeah, I think we can do this on the draw. The good old 20-20-20 strategy. 20 lands, 20 creatures, 20 non-land non-creatures. Alright, what do we got here? We got an Attune, a Cub, a Servant, a Ronas, and Ronas is great. I'm into keep. Opponent's going to 6. This is likely one of the hands we'll probably lead on Servant on 2, because we know our opponent has a Braid, and we'll want to try to grow our Cub to 4-4 before we just let it fall to something like a Braid. Maybe that changes a little bit now that we have a second Cub. See, our hand shapes up on the next draw step. Electrostatic Pummeler. Alright, yeah, still going to play Servant first here. I'm not guaranteed to hit my land drop. And if I do hit my land drop, and then have Pummeler plus defenses up, I am in a spot to do some serious damage to my opponent. We also know our opponent has another forest in their hand. Alright. Servant down. We'll just run out Cubby. Cubby can be quite large.
Lando?
Roof Beats.
Alright, we're definitely in a really good spot if we can hit a mana source. Like, an Attune would be more than acceptable, but like, an Aether Hub's probably just the best Rahner deck. So I'm getting Glorybringer'd. Oh, we're getting Chandra'd. Ruh-roh. Sorry, Kobito Bib. Oh, add red to the pool. Harness Lightning. Yeah, I don't really want to trade mana to 2-to-1 ratio. Or energy at 2-to-1 ratio. Alright, Forest is certainly acceptable. I'm gonna lead here on Cub. Hope here is that the opponent just tries to Chandra to death, we get to Blossoming Defenses, and then Invigorated Rampage it down on the combat step. And they're casting their top spell. Alright, Forest, sure. We'll go to 14, that's fine. A-OK with me. Let's see. I'm trying to think, we should put both the counters on the Cub here. Definitely going to need to put at least one on it, if not both. I don't think so, because if I do, I'm going to have to use the defense on my turn anyway, so. My opponent has a Harness Lightning. Oh, we're getting Elder Defiended. Jeepers. That's not great. Well, yuck. I guess I could have, like, Blossoming Defenses there and then Invigorated Rampage the Cub. Maybe that would have been correct. Obviously looks certainly more correct now that I drew another Blossoming Defenses. Might have just needed to anyways, though. It was probably just bad letting that resolve. There, at least they're killing my Cub off. So I draw a land here. I think I'm in a reasonable shape to win the game still with Pummeler. Obviously needs to be an untapped land, because Chandra can just minus again. Alright, Aether Hub. Right, Force is good enough. Basically at 2 on the board also. Because Chandra can do 2 to us with the plus 1 ability. Oh gosh, what's this? Alright, Exiled Shelter Thicket. This is a Glorybringer. Okay. So in the Exerted here, we're going to have to Blossoming Defenses and pump energy into our Pummeler. Then we can plus 4, and then plus 2. So let's see here, we can plus 4 and plus 2 makes it 7. Two energy short. So we probably just have to do is go plus 4 this guy. We're at 3. Could just try to ignore the Chandra. So being at 3, basically I have to determine how I want to play this game this turn. So I can either play Game Trail. I'm obviously playing Game Trail Trap, so I guess I can just do that now. I can play Ronas, hold up Blossoming Defenses, attack them for 1. On the next turn, double plus 4 plus 0. And then double that to get to 18. and I'm 1 point short, so the Rona's has to be able to get through in that world. In the other world, it's plus 2, plus 0, plus 4. So that's plus 6 onto the Pummeler, so 14 once doubled, and the Rona's is hitting for 7. Yeah, I think I do like playing Rona's. Alright. So if our opponent draws anything, we need them to draw a creature with not much power. Or not much toughness, rather. So we need to be able to Invigorated Rampage over whatever it may be. Part of the reason why I think it's not correct to just kill the Chandra there is I still have to deal with this Glorybringer then in that world, and I can't actually beat the Glorybringer, so why try to beat something I can't beat? Alright, I think my opponent's F6, so I think we've got this. Both of you, pump this. Huzzah! Alright, sweet. Got there. Alright, everybody, thanks for watching some Pummeler. We'll be right back. We'll chat about the deck momentarily. And a number of different things we can do with it.
Alright, everybody. Another 3-2 here with another deck we're showing off. I think my lack of familiarity with Pummeler showed in at least one of those games. I don't think I played particularly well against my first teamer energy opponent, as I didn't really know how to navigate the game to actually build up a large creature and sneak it through for the points of damage that needed to connect. I was particularly disappointed with Voltaic Brawler the whole league. Every time I drew it, it would just trade down on mana, trade even on mana. And trading even on mana could be fine, but the problem is that because it generates 2 energy, it only produces enough energy for Cub. It doesn't produce enough energy for the Pummeler or the Hydra on its own. Therefore, it really needs to combo with an Aether Hub, an Attune, or a Servant to ever really generate a meaningful amount of energy. And then therefore, we're just playing like this 2-mana 3-2 or 2-mana 4-3 on attacking. And I mean, let's face it, standards come a long way. 2-mana 4-3 attackers are just not the ballpark you want to be in. So in particular, I was like pretty disappointed at the Brawlers. Wasn't too stoked in Large in Life. So I like the Invigorated Rampages, as they allowed you to sneak in points a bit more effectively than the Large in Life being instant rather than sorcery. And, Jesus, the sideboard was a mess. So I don't think the Heroic Interventions are very good. I don't think that you want to be bringing these in against red board sweepers like Kozilek's Return, Radiant Flames or Sweltering Suns, as you're not getting enough of a mana advantage there. Greenbelt Rampager, its size is just not important enough unless you're using it to, I think specifically, Crew Heart of Kirin. I think that's exactly what the card is designed for, that and finding a way to get up to 2 energy, pump energy into the Cub, then just turn your green mana into get an energy. Sort of fireball for green energy into +1/+1 counters in your Cub. The Braids were fine, Sweltering Suns were fine, Chandras were fine. The Sky Sovereign I was not as impressed with. The Glorybringers I think also fine, but not particularly impressive. I don't know if that's a product of I played, you know, 2 other Glorybringer decks, or if that's a product of I don't exactly know where Glorybringer wants to be coming in, but obviously, if I could play Hydras 5, 6, and 7, I would certainly do that in a heartbeat, as most of the time what I wanted was just a way to turn on Rona's that was actually protected. And Glorybringer, while it would turn on Rona's, was just, you know, this lightning rod for removal. As people would want to configure their decks as just grit falls for removal against you, as ways to kill the creatures, prevent you from comboing them off. And Glorybringer just, like, did not add into that game plan at all. Similarly, Sky Sovereign, all my creatures are getting killed. It's much harder to crew the silly thing. So, I don't know that red-green is the way to do it. I do think Pummeler was actually really good. Like, there were a number of games, like the Mardu game, in particular where it didn't feel like we had any business winning, where, all right, 20 ball you because the opponent attacked out of nowhere. There were a number of spots where, like, the Gengar at one life against the Chandra and the Glorybringer, had to attack our opponent for one, and then managed to invigorate a Rampage, turn on our Ronas, and get in with Pummeler, Ronas, pump up the Pummeler, and dealt just enough damage that way. Like, that game was also sweet. So I think Pummeler itself is very good, but I think I was really disappointed with, like, Servant, Brawler, Larger Than Life, Glorybringer, and Sky Sovereign. So I think if I were actually going to play this deck, I would actually look to try to adapt to where the metagame is adapting, which I think is moving away from those these monocolored aggro decks. And I think I would actually try to move towards something like this. The reason why I'd want to move into Teemer is you get more places to kind of place your energy. The thing that I'm the least sure of here is whether or not two Ronas could possibly fit into the deck, as I would want more ways to get to four power creatures. I mean, Ronas does that pretty well as you're making Thopters, you get to six mana, which this version is much more likely to. I mean, maybe not much more likely. It has two less cycle lands, just one additional mana source in general. But you have extra outlets for your energy. You have just more energy, I think, in general, in terms of, like, you're not going to trick yourself into spending energy on a four-power Voltaic Brawler, as you don't really want to be spending two mana to gain two energy, and you also don't want to be spending one energy to deal one additional point of damage. It's just not really relevant to the cause. Another one of the key additions here, I think, of picking up blue. I mean, Rogue Refiner is obviously great, as one of the key problems we had was just card flow. If we could just keep up on cards with the Teemer energy opponents, and particularly the control X, I think that'd be really huge. The Aethersphere Harvesters are sort of concession to, well, now our mana base is much worse against red, as we're not going to be three colors. Maybe we won't be able to play our blue three drops very consistently on turn three. I mean, we do have 13 blue sources plus the four tunes, if you count those as 17. But it's not like the most likely ever. I think another thing you could do is potentially go up one more land, take this away from like a Teemer Pummeler combo deck, maybe move it slightly more towards like a controlling combo deck where you only play like two Rampages in the main and then you have like Confiscation Coup and cards like that in the sideboard. Put it three Glorybringers in the sideboard this time, as I felt like that would need more ways to animate Ronas, but I don't think that you actually need three unless you're going to play two Ronas. And I think that Glorybringer is probably better in this version, as you're going to play slightly longer games, as the blue cards are going to tend to lead themselves towards you playing more 7 and 8 turn games as opposed to more 4 and 5 turn games. That being said, I've not played, you know, more than a few games with this version of the deck, so I cannot advocate for or against it, but this is a list of Pummeler that I have played in the past, or at least somewhat similar to it, where I'll be honest, I don't think I had Ronas, because that was before Amonkhet, and certainly didn't have, therefore, a Braid or Glorybringer in the list. But that being said, I still think that Pummeler itself is good. It's interesting how the metagame is shifting as we're moving away from, say, zombies and black-green, and it feels like we're moving more towards just, like, this open field where there's, like, this blue-black reanimator deck with Scarab God, there's mono-red, there's, like, various green mid-range decks, mostly featuring Teemer, to a lesser extent black-green, and the format's just sort of wide open, so I'm interested. It's going to be interesting to see what happens this weekend at Denver, as the Moto metagame tends to be a little bit further ahead than the live metagame, but I'll be interested to see if the live metagame just turns into a what I like to call a dumpster fire, where everyone's just kind of playing their own deck. No one really knows what the best deck is anymore, and we're all just out there battling with whatever cards we like. And with that, everybody, that is going to do it for me this week. Thank you for tuning in and watching. Please go ahead and leave any comments for me in the comment section below, as I will finally be moved into my new place, and I want to get back to more of you guys, and it would be much nicer to be able to communicate with the fans some more. So thanks for watching, and I will see you next week. Bye, everybody.